Okay, Genesis chapter 13, from verse 1 to 15. I'll read. And Abram went up out of Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot with him into the south. And Abram was rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. And he went on his journey from the south even to Bethel, unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Ai, unto the place of the altar which he had made there at the first. And there Abraham called on the name of the Lord, and Lot also, which went with Abraham, had flocks and herds and tents. And the land was not able to bear them, that they might dwell together, for their substance was great, so that they could not dwell together. And there was a strife between the herdmen of Abraham's cattle and the herdmen of Lot's cattle. And the Canaanite and the Perizzite dwelt in the land. And Abraham said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my herdmen and thy herdmen. For we be brethren. Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou would take the left hand, then I will go to the right. Or if thou would depart to the right hand, then I will go to the left. And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of Eden, as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as thou comest unto Zoar. Then Lot chose him all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated themselves the one from the other. And Abram dwelled in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelled in the city of the plain, and pitched his tent toward Sodom. But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord, exceedingly. And the Lord, verse 14, if you have your Bible, you can underline that. And the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thy eyes and look from the place where thou art northward, and southward, and eastward, and westward. For all the land which thou seest, to thee I will give it, and to thy seed forever and ever. Verse 16 said, and I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if any man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. Amen. 2 Corinthians, the second scripture this morning, you can write it down, verse 15 and 16. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when he shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Nevertheless, every time Moses is read, you know, the Bible said the gospel is hid to them that are lost. Amen. And I will tell you why we read 2 Corinthians 3. I want to talk about the veil this morning. I want to talk about the word veil. And the reason why I believe the Holy Spirit wanted me to share this is more of an encouragement to you and to me, and also an admonition or correction to somebody and to myself. Like I told you this morning, I woke up from a dream and I saw myself. I was crying in the dream. And I woke up crying at the same time, and I saw tears in my eyes, and I just had to wipe out the tears, and I stood up before going down to pray. And I was battling in my spirit for hours and said, Lord, what is the meaning of this dream? I can't really relate to it. What is really going on? What are you trying to say? Is it just a random dream, or does this have any significance, any meaning? And then suddenly, as I was praying in the spirit, just thinking about everything that is going on, and suddenly the Holy Spirit said, yes, it is something that I want you to sit back and think about and begin to reason. And two words came to me based on also, we had a wonderful discussion in my home in the evening prior with my boys, and we were talking, and I learned something. And I'm saying this to say, to tie it to what I believe God wants us to learn this morning. And I realized something which I already know, but again, it became more clear to me yesterday evening that anger actually is tied to pride, right? It's something that we know already. Pride is actually the reason for most anger, my ego. You know, the reason why I'm angry, the reason why I get angry most times is because my pride is being touched in a way. You know, and pride, the Bible says, goes before a fall. And when a man is proud, it's a very dangerous place to be in life. And the reason why I get resentful, it is born out of my pride, where my ego has been touched, whether I'm young or old. And as I began to learn and understand that, and so pride also can be a big veil. Before I said anything, what is a veil? Veil is what you say is a covering, mostly in the Old Testament and in the Bible times. And if you go back in the Middle East and some part of the North today, now we have a lot of controversy about women covering themselves in a veil. When you cover yourself in a veil, is to make yourself practically invisible. And the Bible talks about a veil that covers the children of Israel so they do not see. And the word lot, I'm saying all that to say that more than anything else, I realized, because this morning I was battling in my spirit. I said, Lord, what exactly is this, what has this dream got to do with me and every one of us? And then the Lord brought me back to the story of Lot again. I said, yeah, I've read that story and I know what it means and I've preached about it. And then the Holy Spirit said, no, there is something else I want you to get this morning. And it was a struggle. And I was looking at the time, and I'm just trying to get my mind wrapped around this. And I realized that the word Lord, the name Lord, actually literally means veil, a covering. You know, that which covers, and not to cover, to hinder. And I said, okay, that is something else. If Lot means a veil, a hindrance, and something that covers, literally, that is the meaning of the name Lot. And here was the Abraham was called, before he became Abraham, was Abraham. He was called from the land in Genesis chapter 12. You know the story when they started, and God called him out of the land of the Chaldeans and said, come with me into the land that I will show you. Abraham was a man of faith. He followed God, but he also was a man of emotion. Amen. And so sometimes our emotion can destroy us. Our good intention can destroy us. And so because of his emotion, he decided to take along with him this young man. Amen. And that was not God's instruction. Amen. God didn't say take Lot with you. God knew Lot's predicament. God can take care of Lot. God can handle Lot's situation. It was not part of the program. But the good news or the good thing was that Abraham, that the right thing to do was that there were two reasons. I believe that this is my own understanding why Abraham decided to go with Lot. One was that he was 75 years old when God called him, and practically, biologically speaking, there was no chance of him ever having a child again. And so here was this orphan nephew of his. Why not? Why not adopt him? Good thinking. Wrong. Right at the same time. So why not adopt him and take him with me? And so maybe he can become my heir because it's part of the family. It's in the family. And so that was, I believe, part of what formed his decision in taking Lot along with him. And what happened is that we saw in the part that the part of the spirit of Lot that covers and veils us and hinder us, you know, is also tied to pride and greed, you know. And you read the story we read just now in chapter 13. When Abraham said to Lot, which was not the right thing to do, and he said, choose what you want, his greed took the better part of him. You know, he looked at the plane and he wondered what is best. And it's just a picture of what sometimes can destroy us. What can, you know, the Bible said, we do not judge by mere appearance, but what we see, you know. making a right judgment. So we looked at that. And as I begin to see that this morning, I began to say, okay, and there is something here about this man that becomes an issue that the Lord decided to put a story for you and me to learn. And from my own experience, how emotionally we make decisions, even in relationship, based on emotional decisions in relationship in regards to our friends, our loved ones, and families that end up becoming a thorn in our flesh. How many of us have made decisions based on the fact that, he's my brother, he's my friend, we grew up together, you know what I mean? He's my cousin, and all the senses in you is telling you, no, 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 but you don't listen, right? And, she's my best friend, and we grew up together, we went to the same school, we've been through a lot together, so I'm going to bring her into my house, and now she's homeless, I'm bringing her home, and I know her, she's a wonderful woman, and we've known each other, and then suddenly 2 months later that best friend takes your husband, and you're like, but I should have seen that coming. Amen. You know, every judgment went to the wind, and you didn't see it because there was a veil that covers you. That emotional veil just blinds you to reality, to see things, and so greed, pride leads to greed, and greed leads to selfishness. Selfishness brings pride and strife and bitterness and contention. And we saw that manifested just briefly in the life of Lot and the headsman of Abraham, because it has nothing to do with Abraham. Abraham had a connection with God that was so solid that he wasn't suffering from any of those maladies that Lot was suffering from. But because Lot was in his life at that point in time, everything wasn't going the way it should go. And until, the Bible said, you read the story in 14 and 15, until Lot was separated, that was when God showed up. Until the veil was removed. And suddenly God came to him. Because the veil can become, and also emotional instability is a veil. The Bible says a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways, and that man cannot receive anything from the Lord. Amen. And so you see that veil of emotional instability. And that was part of the problem, I believe, that Abraham, I want to say, encountered, because if he had allowed his spirit to speak to him instead of his emotion, he wouldn't have moved with Lot in the first place. That's what that's the point I'm trying to bring out this morning. If he had listened to his spirit instead of his emotion. You know, because when we are emotional, we are irrational. And when we are emotional, we are, you know, we just do things like that. You know what I mean? Emotional people don't think things through. We do things as part of the moment. The emotional people, you know, many sin that we fall into is born out of emotion, right? My emotion wants it. Lust, again, L-U-S-T, actually, again, my understanding means I must have it now. That is emotional people. There's no instant gratification. I want it to happen for me now, right? So I see her, and I want her now. And something inside of you is saying, pop, 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 pop. No, this is going to destroy you. You don't wait. Amen. Because your emotion is higher. It's more. Your flesh is more alive than your spirit man. And when you don't crucify the flesh, you end up making bad decisions all the time. Your good intention can become evil spoken of. You meant well, but it may end up bad. How many of us stand up and say, actually, I thought I was doing the right thing? Thinking that you're doing it does not mean you did it. I thought I was, but something inside of me was saying, no, 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 no. But this thing saying, yeah, 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 yeah. And you just keep drawing around. And this is what destroyed, I believe, that put a block in Abraham's destiny for a while. And God was trying to show us something. And he showed me that this morning. And I began to say, why is that so? And God said, that is what it is. Abraham was a man of faith. He believed God. It was credited unto him for righteousness. We read wonderful stories about Abraham. The good news about Father Abraham is that he has a picture of faith. We see weakness, we see strength, we see failure, we see all kinds of things that depict a real man, right? Everyday story is the Bible. Amen. When you read the Bible from every other book, you know, it's an everyday story. It is the only book that will put out the weakness of their hero. Amen. That is the only book you'll find a hero and you hear their flaws. But because when you see Superman and Spider-Man, they don't have any weakness. Amen. And that is not a hero. And then nobody can identify with that. But when you read the story of Abraham, okay, you can see yourself there. But I can't see myself in Superman or Spider-Man. I can't fly. Amen. You know what I mean? But it is in our story that we see real people, real heroes, having real weaknesses, real defeat, and picking up again and moving forward. That their weakness was not an indictment against them, but became a stepping stone for a greater thing in the life of those people and their family. And so God was able to project that for us. God hides nothing from you and me. He shows us that part of Abraham. Why would somebody like Abraham make such a grave mistake? Father of faith. Oh, hide that. Don't show that. You know how we talk about our family stories? Hush. Don't say that. There are things about your home that no matter how close you are to me, you won't tell me. No. You trust me, but you don't trust me that much. Amen. But God trusts you. The Bible said the secret of the Lord is with them that fear him. And so the Lord just reveals everything to us. And so we begin to see the weakness and the flaws of this man, Abraham. And this is what I'm learning this morning from him. That we should not allow emotional sentiment to get in the way of God's move in our life. Emotional sentiment. And this is what I was learning this morning. Do not allow emotional sentiment to get in the way of God's plan and purpose for your life. That all good ideas are not God's ideas. That is good does not mean it's God's. But if it is God, it's good. Right? It may not make sense. You may not like it, but it's good. If it is all, every God idea is a good idea. But all my good ideas are not necessarily God's idea. And this is something I want you to get. And this is what was dropped in my spirit this morning. That not all good ideas are God's idea. That it sounds noble does not mean it's from God. That is a good thing does not mean God is in it. It was good for Abraham to take his orphan nephew. It is good to help the poor. Right? You remember when one of the disciples, I believe it was Judas, was saying, oh, this perfume should have been sold, and the money being used to feed what? The poor. And Jesus said, the poor you always have with you. Right? That was a good idea. That was a very noble statement to make. Jesus said, I've come to the poor. I've come for the poor. Jesus was all about the poor. How would Jesus now say, how can Jesus be so rude? What's a sarcastic statement? How can Jesus be so callous? We're talking about the poor that you came for here. And this extravagant perfume, do you know how many poor people it will feed? Very good, noble idea. But God was not in it because the agenda was completely different. And this is what God is saying to somebody here, to me this morning. You see, every good and perfect gift comes from the Lord. James chapter 1, verse 17, every good and perfect gift comes from the Lord. In Romans chapter 8, verse 28, say what? All things work together for the good of them that love God and are called according to his word, purpose. And so if I let noble ideas and my lofty ideas to get in the plan, in the way of God's purpose and plan for my life, they may sound noble and nice, but is God really part of that? And so most of the things that we are going through in our life this morning, is it because God is... is God trying to tell me something? Is there a veil that is covering me from really seeing what God is trying to tell me? This question this morning. In Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12, he said, there is a way that seems right to a man. Right? And so that is a good idea, like I said, does not mean it's from God. There is a way that seems right to a man, that the end thereof is destruction. He said, my ways are not your ways, neither am I taught your taught. There is a way that seems right. But all God's idea, again, I emphasize that, is a good idea. Every God's idea are good. It may not look good to you right now, but if God is in it, just be sure that when it's all over, like Job said, I will come out as pure gold. Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 4 says, he is the rock and his work is perfect. Everything that God does are perfect. And this is what God is saying to me and is saying to you. God is calling us to a time of separation. What is the veil? That is the question to you and to me this morning. What is the veil covering you and me this morning? And God is saying, separate. Are we listening quietly? Or does it have to come into a chaotic situation before we hear, like Abraham and Lot? Amen. Because if that strife did not come true, if there was no quarrel and infighting between those two brothers, and Abraham would be waiting for the fulfillment of the promises of God, and he'd be wondering, why is God taking time? Why is God not answering my prayer? Well, I'm praying, I'm fasting, I'm doing everything they've asked me to do. I'm a faithful child of God, and I've searched myself, and there is no sin in me. What is causing this delay? There was a lot. A hindrance that looks insignificant, that doesn't look like anything, looks like a very noble habit and a noble idea. Because you see, listen, we must always remember that the call to separation is not just a physical one, it's also much more a mental and moral and spiritual separation too. Because there are things that you are clinging to that is hindering the manifestations of the promises of God in your life and in my life. There are relationships that are not meant to be. There are friends that you don't even need in your life. I'm telling you, they are good people, but God says you don't need them. They are nice, they are wonderful. There's nothing wrong with them, but God, who sees the end from the beginning, is saying, as long as this relationship is on, forget about the promise from coming true. Because if it does come true, this is going to destroy what I want to do. Because what I do, whatever God does, endures forever. God is not, it's not from my country, so he doesn't do abandoned project. Amen. Amen. If my God is not Nigerian government, let me use that. If you go to my country, there's a lot of elephant project. They started halfway and they abandoned it. You know what I mean? Nobody counts the cars. They just go into this big project, and they just start, and halfway through they run out of money, or somebody embezzles the money, or something. You know what I mean? The story is, there is all, something happened. God is not like that. And so God will not start something that he's not going to finish. Amen. You have this big dream, this big vision, this big plan that God has said to you. God is showing you the word. God is saying, you can come to heaven. You're not going to hell, but your son will do what you're not. So, you know what I mean? There are things that God wants me to do, wants you to do. And the Lord is saying, you can wait until thy kingdom come. You can cast all the demons that you know, but until you separate yourself. The Bible says, be thou separate and come out from among them, and I'll be your God. There is a time of separation. This is the hour and the season of separation. What is the veil that you have allowed to cover you? That is the question this morning to you and to me. What is blocking your vision? What is stopping you from seeing what God is saying, or hearing what God is saying to you, seeing what God is saying to you? Abraham was a man of faith. He stepped out in faith. He went where he knew not. He just stood up blindly, following God. What a manifestation, a demonstration of faith. But there was Lot with him. And the Bible will say, and Lot went with him. I keep wondering, I read chapter 12 and 13 this morning. I kept wondering, why was God emphasizing that? Every time God, Abraham doing something, read chapter 12 and 13 today. And you'll see, every time he's doing something, and the Bible will emphasize that, emphasis, and Lot was with him. And Lot went with him. And Lot came with him. And Lot, why was that? Because most times when God mentions things about people, it's once, and then the story just continues. But in this instance, every time Abraham is about to do something, Lot was there. And then it becomes an uncompleted project. When Lot shows up, it became uncompleted. What is stopping your project from entering into its fullness? In your journey of faith, child of God, who are you carrying with you that is not supposed to be? That is the question this morning. In this great journey of faith and this wonderful promises of God for your life, who are you carrying on this trip with you? What is the Lot with you? Who is the Lot in your life? What is that habit that won't let you hear God or see God? Because Lot will hinder you. Lot will delay you. Lot will not let you hear God or see well. What is hindering you? Anything that you are hanging around or hanging around you that is slowing you down from becoming who God has called you to be, child of God, this morning. I don't know who you are this morning. God is saying, it is time for a quick separation. What is that veil that is covering you and me? Is it a relational veil? Is it a life choice that looks good, but all it has done to you is cause you pain and misery, and you're trying to patch it? You know, there's a word, a local word in my country that we use. They call, what do you call those people that fix when you have a flat tire? Huh? What do you call them here? Vulcanizer? No? Huh? The handyman, like when you have when your tire is right, where you take it out to be fixed. I don't know. There's a name you call. Huh? Okay, in Africa they call them vulcanizer. I don't know where they got that name from, right? And they call it to patch the tire, right? Just to patch into men. And they always say, you know, there are some tires, no matter how much you patch them, they'll still leak. Right? My point this morning is that there are relationships that you're patching, but it's still leaking. It's time to change that completely and take a new tire. It's not worth it. There are habits that you're trying to manage, and they've lied to you and to me, that God understands. But God does not understand sin. God does not understand compromise. God does not understand lie. God does not understand fornication. God does not understand adultery. God does not understand that. Amen. There is no language in the Bible that told me that God understands that. God does not understand the relationship that comes between you and your God-given purpose. Right? And I had this dream, and I can tell you what it is. And it has that to do with people in your life. I was in this dream, and here was a friend or somebody, a color friend, and I'm trying to. And I've made up my mind, I said, okay, we don't need this kind of people in our lives, right? And then this dream, and I saw myself with him again and trying to plan a project. And the same thing that he's doing that makes me angry, right? And I said, no, I don't want to call them. I don't want to have anything. And then he was telling me again, you know, that, oh, he's going to do the same thing. He's doing. And I was sheepishly, right? I'd never confronted him. I was just like, in my spirit, in my mind, I was saying, no, this is wrong. But I didn't say nothing. Right? And I was just looking at him while he was saying, oh, I'm going to go do that again. And I was just like, this is wrong. But it's like I was just dumb. But I wasn't dumb because I couldn't speak. In my mind, I was saying, oh, I don't want to hurt his feeling. And as I said, I was not going, in my mind, I didn't voice it out. I said, it's not good to hurt people's feeling. Just let it there. And then I heard again, this wasn't a dream. And the Lord is saying, oh, it's better to please man than to please God. And before I could turn, he's gone ahead and is doing what he was doing again. But it was too late for me to speak into that. And so I stood there feeling very guilty. And I was crying. I was crying of how much how did I fail God because of the fear of man. And it was in that tears that I woke up. And I said, Lord, I can't reconcile this. What is really going on? And this is how the Holy Spirit took me to the scripture this morning. And is speaking to you and to me. What is that? Especially in the area of people in your life that don't need to be there. It's not every man, every woman. You can be everybody's acquaintance. But it's not everybody that can be your friend. Jesus said, I no longer call you servants, but friends. The word friend, to me, is deeper than brothers. The reason why I looked at it that way is that Jesus turned around to the disciples and said, I no longer call you servants, but friends. Why didn't he say, I call you brothers? Because I used to think that the covenant, the brotherhood, the covenant of brothers is deeper than friendship. But when Jesus looked at his disciples and said, you are my friend, Jesus, God looked at Abraham, he said, Abraham is my friend. And so I believe that before I should call anybody my friend, a friend that sticketh closer, the Bible said, than a brother. So it's not everybody that qualifies to be called a friend. And so there are words we use loosely without knowing the real meaning of them. And friend is one of those words. That is not everybody that is your friend. We are all acquaintances. We are all brothers and sisters. You say a brother is born for adversity, right? But it's not everybody. A brother can become a friend. But a friend is a friend. A friend loveth at all times. A friend, there's an Italian saying that they say, if you want to know how you stand with a man, get yourself in a spot when they don't have to respect you. If they still do, then you know you have a friend in that person. And that is a worldly saying, but it's true. And so Jesus turned around and called his disciples friends. As a Christian, do you have a friend? Do I have a friend in you as a brother, as a church person? But God is saying to you this morning, what is that veil? What is the physical veil? What is the spiritual veil? What is the lot that you've carried along with you on this faith journey and is hindering you? Is stopping the purpose of God from coming to fruition in your life? It's not because God does not want to answer you. It's not because God doesn't want to do it. It's just because God knows that there's somebody or there's something in your life, when that blessing is released, it would die. Can you imagine? Abraham would have died without seeing the fulfillment of God's promise. And God would have raised another to take his place, if not for the mercy of God. Why wait until there's contention and strife before we hear God? Why should we hear God only through kicking and screaming? Why can't we hear God through the still small voice that is saying to you and to me, child of God, examine yourself. Do you need bankruptcy before you wake up? Do you need a divorce before you wake up? Do you need to be exposed in the news media before you wake up? What do you want God to do to get your attention? Because the purpose of God will come to pass in your life and in my life. But does it have to take that? Does it have to take that rough handling before we hear him? Are we that stubborn that we can hear him? We're letting our itchy ears, people are just telling us lies. God is saying it is time to clean house. It is time to separate yourself. Separate yourself. That habit, that lifestyle is stopping God from coming true in your life. You will see God's glory in a newer dimension. Your eyes will be open and you'll begin to see. God said to Abraham, as soon as Lot was separated from him, what did he say? Now. So God has been waiting to show Abraham. Shall we stand up this morning? We've been running from pillar to pole like Abraham. Abraham ran from here to Egypt, to this place, to that place, looking for God. Meanwhile, God was there all along. Like you and me, we go to every conference. We go to that, we go to this, we go to this. There's nothing wrong with that. We're waiting for God. We're just looking for God to speak. And then God is here waiting for you to just... God is saying, it's just like, you know how we play with kids, hide and seek? We're playing hide and seek with the Lord. And the Lord says, see me, see me, see me. And we say, no. Oh, maybe it's in Toronto now. Let us go. You don't hear of a mighty move of God. God is moving in Toronto. And the Lord is the same here and forevermore. Amen. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Amen. The Lord is everywhere, is here now. But are we here with him? Abraham went to Egypt. Like Job said, I went to the east, I looked for him, and he was not there. I went there, he was not. God said, I'm here. Because God is here, God is now. What is holding you from hearing God? This morning, I don't know who you are. But as the Lord speaks to me, and I shared that with you this morning, that veil that is covering you, the veil of ignorance, the veil of pride, is it a veil of anger? Is it a veil of selfishness? Is it a veil of greed? Is it a veil of pornography? Is it a veil of sexual immorality? What is it? And you can go for all the prayer, go to all the prayer houses, go to all the prayer conventions, go to all the prophets to speak into your life. They can speak into your life until they are blue in the face, and you are blue in the face until you are tired and come back again. The Bible says from where he started, that's where he came. You can go around back again to the beginning, where you were with God. the simplicity of your faith. Remember how you were on fire for the Lord until you began to yoke yourself with such friends that began to tell you it's okay. God understand. That they began to tell you it's okay not to serve. You can't be too fanatical. It's okay. You can pray at home. It's okay. You can come. It's okay. God, we've been doing this and God is blessing us. It's not every blessing that is from God. That a man is prospering does not mean it's prosperity. Financial, material prosperity is not an indication of the presence of God in anybody's life. Don't be deceived. People like Bill Gates, they don't speak in tongues. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Donald Trump, I don't think he speaks in tongues. I don't know how many times he goes to church. He's a billionaire. Are we going to use that as a standard? Are we going to use people's money? What is holding you back, child of God? The rain is about to come down. And the Holy Spirit is saying, child of God, separate. Come out from among them and be ye separate. And I'll be your God. Let every man that names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. For the Lord God knows those who are his. We cannot sit on the fence anymore and expect God to move. We cannot have Lot in our midst, in our camp, and expect to see the vision and the glory of God. The devil can prophesy, child of God. Don't be carried away by all those cosmetics and Christianity these days. And I speak to you by the Spirit of God this morning. Don't be carried away by all those show that miracles are happening does not mean God is in it. But if God is in it, miracles will happen. Amen. Is God. Are we showing forth fruit in keeping with our salvation confession? Can God really get you to me? God is trying to get your attention and my attention, child of God. Ask God this morning. And I pray this morning, I say, Lord, give me the courage, give me the strength to cut off every emotional string in my life. Anything that is not of you, I'd rather please you than please man. I'd rather be alone with you than be surrounded by crowds of evildoers in the name of friendship. No, it's not worth it. This race is real. Heaven is real. Don't be deceived by this new thing. Heaven is not here. This is not our home. We are on a journey. We are on a journey. Our promised land is far off yonder. It is not here. We are not working for here. We are working for an eternal home. And that home requires consecration and complete separation from this world and everything that is in it. Ask God to open your eyes to show you. And I don't think you even know. You already know what the veils are. That's what the Holy Spirit is saying. You know what the veil is in your life. You know what is hindering you from entering into the place of God's promise for your life. And God is saying, lay it before me. Ask God for the strength to tell your lot to go. That is your prayer this morning. It's not God to show you. To say God show you is a religious lie. You already know. I already know. Ask God to show you, to help you, not to show you. You already know Lot. You know the Lot in your life. You know the Lot that has to go. Ask the Lord to give you the strength to cut off that string this morning. that habit, that lifestyle, those choices that you have carried along since you became a Christian, you can't let it go. You are a Christian, but you are still known by that. That is the Lord in your life. You are a child of God, you speak in tongues, but they still know you by that. When they describe you as that angry Christian. They describe you as that gossiper, that strength, those lot. Whatever it is, whether it is a spiritual thing or a physical thing, ask for the grace that Abraham had to say, Lord, it is enough. I've come this far with you. You are a hindrance to my life. It is time to go. Father God, I pray for help from above this morning. Father God, in tears, oh God, help us, oh God. Give us the courage and the strength to separate. Empower us, oh God, to say no to Lot. Father God, if we have carried him along ignorantly, Father God, give us the boldness and the courage to say no more. No more. This is how far you will come with me. No further. I'm about to do business with God. I have waited too long. I've delayed. You have delayed me. You have slowed me down. You have hindered me for long. It's now, now, and now the time has come. Enough is enough, Lord. I don't care how offended you feel, but it's time for me to go. God is calling me to a higher ground. And I can't afford to be yoked with you anymore. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you. It is time. It is time. It is time. It is time. It is time, Lord Jesus. It is time. It is time for a turnaround. It is time. Release that grace, oh God. Because there is room for expansion. What you are about to do in our life, no eyes have seen, no ears have heard, neither have they entered into the heart of man. What God has prepared for you and me. But he will only reveal it to us by the Holy Spirit. And that revelation can only come when Lot is done away with. You want to enter into that new grace, into that new reign? The supernatural becoming natural phenomenon in your life. It is time to say no more. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Help us, Lord. Father God, I pray and commit this church into your hand. Give us, O God, the courage to say no to every ungodly, unrighteous lifestyle. Give us the courage to stand with you, whether we are the only one in this congregation. Father God, give us the courage to say no to ungodliness, yes to the righteous relationship that you want for us to do. Father God, give us the courage to say no, whether our livelihood depend on that relationship. Father God, we choose to trust you. And we break free from them. That we will not compromise the integrity of the scripture, not for a morsel of bread anymore. We will not compromise the integrity of your word for momentary and earthly pleasures of this world. Give us, O God, the faith of Moses that will say no to the pleasures of Egypt and choose suffering because he can see him afar off. Open our eyes to see afar off. Not trucks, not houses. Let us see afar off. Let us see beyond. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we give you praise. We glorify your name this morning. In Jesus' name. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. Go with God. Have a wonderful afternoon.